Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions About Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. And this week, it's our May special subject. We'll be talking about four films by Jacqueline Audry, a fairly recently rediscovered French master of the 40s and 50s, and a little bit beyond. Gigi, from the late 1940s. Olivia, HUIS CLOS, which is also No Exit. And final film, Les Petits Matins, also known as Stop Girl, also known as Hitch-Hike.
Also known as Girl on the Road. Known by many names.
And after that, stay tuned because we will be doing a Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto segment on Sweet Charity, which we saw at the TIFF Lightbox this weekend.
So Dave, you were able to find out some things about Jacqueline Audry.
Yes, the wonderful France Culture app always serves me well when I'm looking into French cinema, French literature, many other topics as well. Not a lot out there on Jacqueline Audry, which is a crime and one that radio program was attempting to begin to redress. They look into the erasure of Jacqueline Audry from film history to some extent. This is a woman who came up through the French film industry in the 1930s. She was a script girl, as they said, and became an assistant director working with Max Ophuls after the war. You know, the war did dislocate a lot of film careers and other lives as well, but after World War II, she gets her chance and starts directing movies, and they were well received, and she was working with big stars throughout the late 40s and 50s. For some reason, the textbooks did not list her. Growing up as a person interested in film history, I would look into these kinds of things. I would read about famous women who had directed movies, and you never saw Jacqueline Audry's name in English language publications, certainly. Apparently, it's not so different in France up until at least the 80s or 90s when they started to bring her back into the story. But the Cahiers du Cinéma did an issue at a certain point on women directors and omitted her, which is crazy because she was the only woman directing movies in a big way, in a commercial way, in France in the 40s and early 50s.
Well, but I mean, I guess maybe the fact that these movies were commercially successful worked against her with the Cahiers people who only liked that in American directors?
Well, they gave certain other directors a pass as well, right? They loved Max Ophuls. He was German, maybe that's why. I don't know. Maybe they just didn't like any of their homegrown. But they liked Renoir. They made some exceptions for the people who were directing in the 30s and 40s.
These four that we saw, they're certainly not stylistically flashy.
Now, and that is part of it. What they look into, apart from the intense misogyny of a lot of the Cahiers people.
Oh yeah, we can't overemphasize that.
But, you know, they did write criticism of Varda, and they treated her movie seriously, but they do not seem to have done the same for Jacqueline Audry. There was one that they quoted from, one article by Eric Rohmer on a mid-1950s film by Audry, and he just lambasts her and talks about how weak all of her mise-en-scène is and seems to have nothing good to say about her, and then sort of offhandedly asks his readers, you know, what is even the word for a female director? As if, you know, there really shouldn't be such a thing. One thing that they do introduce in the radio program is that possibly even her subject matter, or at least the way she came to prominence adapting Gigi, worked against her, because by the 1940s, Colette, the author of Gigi, famous French author we'll talk about in a moment, had become respectable. She had been a very transgressive figure when she first appeared on the literary scene.
Oh yeah, she was an institution by this time, absolutely, which was kind of remarkable because as a female writer, starting in 1900 in France, this was very trailblazing.
Yeah, and we'll talk about her biography and the trajectory of her life, but the fact that these movies like Gigi and Olivia are set around the turn of the century in the Belle Époque, and we're going to look at these movies carefully and closely, I don't think that you can call these movies tame by any stretch of the imagination. Certainly not Olivia, but if you're only looking at the setting...
even Gigi, as well as Olivia, in terms of the treatment of the subject matter, seemed more provocative to me than anything Godard was doing in the 1960s.
For whatever reason, they did lump her in with the cinéma de qualité, the cinéma de papa, this idea of a staid French cinema that was looking backward, dwelling on the pre-war years. The Nouvelle Vague wanted nothing to do with that, and they did not give her much of a look, it seems like, and they just took her out of the histories when they wrote about women making movies. So she did live into the 60s. She made a Nouvelle Vague-style movie, which we will be discussing, Les Petits Matins. She died, unfortunately, in the 1970s in a car accident. Not that old, you know, in her late 60s. If she had lived a little longer, she could have been there for the revival of her films that started in the 1980s. They started to get some play at festivals in France. Took much longer than that, I think, for her reputation to be restored enough in the English language world for people to hear of her. We didn't know much about her until Olivia got restored a few years ago, right? Before we get into the actual movies, we should talk a bit about Colette, because it is a very important collaboration. They worked together on Gigi, and then later on two other films.
Even as late as 1932, Colette was publishing a book called The Pure and the Impure, which was all about the bisexual and homosexual demi-mondaine of which she was part in France. That was a very scandalous publication. So she certainly wasn't respectable at that point when the sound era was being inaugurated.
It may have been something that came about during the war, during those years where France was occupied by the Nazis, and people must have been clutching at the past desperately for anything that felt a little bit more comforting or inspiring than Nazi occupation, and Colette was still alive and was that link to the past, and somehow she became part of the establishment that way. I have no idea. I'm the furthest thing from a Colette expert.
I can talk a little bit about Colette, although I'm certainly by no means an expert, but of the two of us, I guess I am more of one.
Well, you've read most of her books, or all of them.
All the novels. She also wrote a million short stories. I have not read all of those.
Were they all translated?
Oh, yeah. Basically, when I was 12, reading B.C. Andrews novels and Star Trek novelizations, hadn't really discovered the wide world of classic literature, I came across an article on Colette in Cosmopolitan magazine that summarized her life as I'm about to do now, and decided, oh yeah, that's for me. Went to the library as soon as I was given my adult library card, went to the library and read all of her books and a couple of biographies. Got really obsessed. Decided to cut my hair into a short bob. Never looked back, because I was much more comfortable being androgynous as I made my way through puberty into adolescence. Colette actually makes a cameo appearance in this film, not Colette herself, but an actress playing her and her husband, and another figure by the name of Polaire that I'll talk about soon. So I guess this is sort of a cutesy meta-reference to Colette's once scandalous past that we can now all wink at and pat on the back. But when she was around 19, she was a girl from the provinces, as they say in Gigi. She was introduced to a family friend, Willie, who was a writer and publisher of some kind, and basically just a Parisian roué. They married. He was in his mid-30s, I think, although he looked much older. So when I was a 12-year-old looking at pictures of them, I had him pictured as much older than that in my mind, and the age difference as much bigger.
A dissipated man.
A very dissipated man, yes. He looked it, and he was it. So he put her to work writing for him once they were in Paris together, and he had the idea, the marketable idea, that his young wife would write about her schoolgirl days, but make it spicy with lots of lesbian crushes. And he helped her out with that. She does credit him with making her into a writer, because he literally would lock her in a room until she produced enough pages to satisfy him. And she said, I would never have done it otherwise.
That's still pretty creepy.
Very creepy relationship. The Claudine series, starting with Claudine à l'école, became wildly popular. There was a stage play. Claudine was played by Polaire. mainly famous for the fact that she had a 16-inch waist. Willie then, as a publicity stunt, had them both dress up as Claudine, and he took them around Paris together with him, implying that they were a threesome, which may or may not have been true. There was all the spicy lesbianness in the novels, of course. Also, the Claudine novels and stage play generated a huge fandom of Claudine groupies, who would also dress up as her and throw themselves at Willie, who did take advantage of this, and other women. Eventually, Colette got tired of all of this, managed to publish the final Claudine novel under her own name. Otherwise, it was all under Willie's name, and also he got all the money for it. Left him, went on the stage. That in itself was, of course, a very scandalous profession. She did trade on sex to make money. There are some interesting pictures out there of her dressed in Egyptian costume and doing all sorts of mimes. At this time, she started experimenting with lesbianism. If she hadn't done it before, she went at it in a serious way now, had relationships with some famous aristocratic lesbians, and above all with Missy, who dressed as a man, and they lived together openly initially. Obviously, enormous scandal. But by 1920, she is married, respectably married to a man, a wealthy man. She writes the novel Cherie, which became, again, wildly famous and scandalous, which was about 50-year-old courtesan who is in a quasi-incestuous relationship with a 19-year-old man, the chéri of the title. Their relationship definitely has maternal overtones. There was recently a Stephen Frears movie made of it with Michelle Pfeiffer as Leia, the courtesan. And then a couple of years later, she turned around, Colette, that is, and seduced her 15-year-old stepson when she was 47.
So she had a plan and she executed.
Life imitated art. It was a very Woody Allen and Sun Yi type situation because there was this familial connection, probable attraction of the incest taboo, but at the same time she had never been any kind of actual parental figure to him. But he was in her care for one summer during which she seduced him. He wrote about it in his memoirs. He thought it was fantastic. Great way to lose your virginity. Would have happily spent the rest of his life with her. I think the affair went on for about 4 years. But she decided to eventually enact the renunciation scene from her novel. Otherwise he would have kept going. Yeah, I mean, obviously she was very famous, very charismatic, and generally considered a genius, so he thought he got a good deal there. That brings us up to The Pure and the Impure, where she's writing about some of the people she encountered while she was having these theatrical adventures and lesbian affairs. But yeah, I guess apparently by 1944, by the time she wrote Gigi, just considered a boring old grand dame of literature.
Ready to become an international sensation as Gigi proliferates around the world.
Well, yeah, because in 1951, she discovers Audrey Hepburn by selecting her for Anita Loos' Broadway version of Gigi, and then there is a musical version, right, that becomes the Minnelli film.
Which is a movie I saw when I was a teenager, and it really creeped me out, and I never watched it again, despite being a big Minnelli fan. It's something I'll have to revisit.
It's a tremendously creepy movie in a really embalmed way. It's creepy because it's not creepy, sort of. Like, it's treating really creepy subject matter in a very overt way, but it's at the same time so desexualized that somehow makes it twice as creepy. For example, Maurice Chevalier's singing Thank Heaven for Little Girls, and that character really means it.
Yes, but he also looks really, really old in that movie, and maybe not threatening anymore. I don't know.
Yeah, exactly. He's not the actually dangerously phallic Maurice Chevalier of the Jeanette MacDonald movies.
He's even a lot crustier looking than the Honoré in the Audrey Gigi.
Right. Also, Leslie Caron is probably, of the famous actresses who play Gigi, like Audrey Hepburn and Danielle Delorme, they were in their early 20s. Leslie Caron is in her late 20s in the musical.
Yeah, it's true. She had been in the Hollywood movies for 10 years by the time Gigi was made. No one could have actually thought she was a teenager.
No, and I'm not even sure. I feel certain the movie does not mention that the character is supposed to be 15. This movie does frequently. It does.
Yeah, it makes a big point of it. Now, as you say, Colette made a big deal about discovering Audrey Hepburn, but before that, she made a big deal about discovering Daniel Delorme. This was her big break as well, and I heard an interview with Colette from this time, as she told the interviewers that as soon as she saw Daniel Delorme, "That's Gigi, c'est Gigi," she exclaimed. So she recognized her character twice, at the very least.
Yeah, these actresses do not seem to have much in common at all.
She did not live to see the Leslie Caron version of the film, but I doubt she would have said the same thing about Leslie Caron.
That's just your opinion. She might have said it about any cute young actress who would bring yet further fame to the role. Maybe the fact was that by 1944, Colette herself was so famous and all of her scandals had been so completely absorbed into French society that she couldn't do anything to shock anybody anymore. So maybe it's less that this novella is actually more toothless than what she was writing previously, than that people were just used to her. Because I don't feel like this is a toothless work at all, this film.
Well, the film certainly isn't, and I haven't read the book, so I don't know. If the axis of acceptance or non-acceptance or transgressiveness for Colette is how much homosexual desire it depicts, though this one doesn't really have any of that.
No, but the extreme youth of the heroine and her relationship with an adult man that definitely has disturbing incestuous overtones, that's all there. And so is the, at times, icy social satire.
Yeah, very much so. So should we get into the film itself?
Yeah, I think so.
It's the story of Gilberte Gigi. She is almost 16. She has been raised in a family of women who never marry. They are mistresses, courtesans. That is their lot in life. That is their trade as a family. It's passed on from one generation to the next. They reign in level of success within that role. We have the aunt, the great aunt, who has been all around the world and been a mistress to princes and wealthy industrialists. Grandmother is a little bit more down to home. She certainly has had affairs. She was involved with Honoré for a time. They had a chalet together that they reminisce about when they meet on the beach. The mother is not much of a figure at all in the movie. She appears briefly, but nobody really listens to her. I don't know if that's the case in the book too. It seems like it's got to be from the book.
I don't think I've read a Colette novel since I was 16. And you know what? I would like to reread them because I read these books because they were dirty. I mean, they lived up to that. It was a good rite of passage from B.C. Andrews to Colette, but I'm pretty sure I was not properly appreciating them. And everyone says that Colette is a master of the French language, Dave, so you should maybe actually check them out,
yeah,
in French.
Yeah, I should. Now, it's interesting, though, that the women of the older generations, they do kind of present three different subject positions, three different outcomes for this same life. You have the aunt, just seems aristocratic and seems like she has lived this incredible life and knows everything and has all this savoir-faire that she is able to communicate to Gigi. Doesn't seem to have any regrets. Whether she does or not, secretly doesn't come across.
Mamita's sister training Gigi for this lifestyle. She seems like she could be a more externally viewed version of Leia in Thierry.
Now, Mamita seems to be someone who is kind of conflicted because we're told, yeah, she lived this courtesan lifestyle. At this point, though, she is a grandmother. She makes tea. She is very welcoming and comforting for Gaston and presumably for other men that come to visit at their home. But she no longer seems interested in being a sex object, certainly. She seems to have left that part behind. She doesn't seem destroyed by it or anything either, though. She's just become, you know, a very admirable woman. I love the actress that plays her, too. Yvonne Debré. And she really has this solidity to her. The mother, nobody seems to have time for her or care about her. She doesn't seem to care about her daughter or have any part in really raising her. They don't call her a bad woman, but they just don't seem to think she's become much of anything that anyone should care about or pay any attention to. So I guess that's an outcome too. She's become totally frivolous and superficial, which would have to be a possible outcome of living that kind of life as well.
Sure. What we see here with these two characters, with Gigi and Gaston, are two people who, and I mean, this maybe is what might give the novella an air of conservatism, two people who do not fit into the plans that their social role has laid out for them.
They're rejecting the sexy roles of the Belle Époque, basically. The roué and the courtesan.
Yeah, absolutely. They're not cut out for it. All that they want to do is get together, drink chamomile tea, play piquet. And Gigi always beats him. What they remind me of, other than the vast age difference, like Gaston's got to be in his late 20s, early 30s, and disturbing uncle-niece type relationship. She actually calls him uncle for most of the movie.
He's not her uncle, though.
And acts like he's her uncle.
He does.
And she acts like he's her uncle. Other than that, they remind me a lot of, and the character's relationship to their world is similar as well, of Jack Lemmon and Shirley MacLaine in The Apartment, who are also rejecting these superficial, sex-drenched roles that have been laid out for them.
Yeah, it's true. Gaston, I really like this actor's performance.
Nothing like the handsome lover-like Louis Jourdan in the Minelli movie.
No, this is just a basic, clean-cut, Belle Époque mustache guy. He wants to relax. He's dyspeptic.
It's old for his time, whereas his creepy old uncle is much more spry and youthful than he is.
Yeah, and transgressive, tweaking and irritating the oldsters who are Gaston's parents. He's got more in common with his parents than with his uncle, but they've somehow struck up a friendship anyway. They leave together.
They're quite the odd couple.
Honoré teases him for having a budget, the expenses for this new car. What are you doing with a budget at your age? You're supposed to be spending the family fortune and not worrying about anything. Rich young guy, you're supposed to be just sleeping with everyone, driving everything, and letting your parents pick up the pieces. But Gaston, no. I mean, his...
Are these moderns? Are Gigi and Gaston somehow moderns who are emerging from the Belle Époque? Who are rejecting it? Who are bored with it?
Yeah, I mean, that's the sense that you get. It's hip to be square. Honoré is off to meet an 18-year-old who's turning 19 soon.
Ugh.
And he's very old. He's the Maurice Chevalier character. Gaston wants to go sit at Mamita's house. He doesn't even see Gigi. He just sits there drinking chamomile tea with Mamita the first visit.
Yeah, but he asks about her.
He asks about her.
He always wants to hang out with Gigi.
He does, but it's not like he goes there only for Gigi. No. Loves hanging out with Mamita.
She's part of the whole
cozy family
environment
atmosphere.
That he wants there. Yeah, she's just a part of it.
And you could see he's getting some kind of an ulcer from thinking about what is expected of him as an eligible rich guy, which is that he's supposed to be getting ready to marry some rich woman that he can then cheat on every night of the week with various mistresses and courtesans.
And it feels like one woman is more than he needs.
That's right. I mean, he does have a girlfriend. We do meet her not too far into the film. He brings Gigi along with him to the Ice Palace to meet this date. She has received many jewels from him, but has no interest in him and is, in fact, having an affair of her own with her ice dancing teacher at the Ice Palace. Gaston watches all of this. He does not seem actually angry at her because he doesn't care about her, but he knows he's supposed to be pissed.
He's the cuckold.
Yeah, it's not a good look. And he sits there drinking with Gigi. He gets her a balbotage, which we were trying to figure out exactly what it is. I think it's a slush. In Quebec, they call that a balbotin. So that's probably what it is. Although everyone I ever knew called it just our slush. But the real name in Quebec is balbotin.
It didn't look that slushy, but she does think it's good.
She drinks it with a straw, and it fits in with an ice palace too, because they would have ice shavings around to throw into the drink. I don't know.
What?
Anyway, they watch Gaston peevishly, Gigi kind of mischievously, as this woman goes around the ice. Gigi does call her fat.
Well, I think she just means she has a figure, unlike Gigi, supposedly.
Yeah, exactly. Pretty clear there's something off here. There's something going on that this relationship is not bringing very much fun to Gaston. And we have seen already that she's making plans with her paramour on the ice. She wants nothing to do with Gaston. So it's not like a matter of conjecture. We know.
I suppose the fact that Gigi insults this woman does mean she's already got a crush on her uncle. But that wouldn't be terribly abnormal even for an actual uncle.
She's definitely jealous of this woman who is an adult, right? And is looked on as a more independent figure who can make her own decisions, etc., etc. Now, we know there are limitations placed on adult women.
Well, we're about to see some, because there's quite the comic sequence. Gaston and Honoré decide to surprise the mistress with her lover.
And this all comes about, it's a pretty involved scene with Gaston, Honoré, and Honoré's manservant.
This is the physical comedy peak of the movie.
They conceive the plan, right? They talk at length about what do you do when you're cuckolded. It's going to happen to everyone at a certain point because you're sleeping with so many women or trying to. Some of them aren't really going to like you and are just going to take your jewels and sleep with other
men. Well, I think we're meant to believe that in La Belle Époque society that everyone's cheating on everybody all the time.
Yeah, and Honoré is just like, no, it's like a notch on your belt. There's no problem, and this is how you deal with it. While he's doing this, Honoré is bedridden because he spends at least one day every week not moving, being catered to by his servant, and drinking only eggnog. That seems to be drugged because he falls asleep whenever he has the eggnog. I guess there's a lot of rum in it, I don't know.
Probably.
I always liked that too, and this is true in Quebec as well. Eggnog is called lait de poule.
Yes.
Honoré says, this is what I did, and he sort of starts to tell the story, but the camera takes us to this inn where we know the courtesan is shacked up with the ice teacher. They go to confront her, and they drive over there in their early automobile that is a real contraption.
These furry automobile outfits on, and they
goggles and everything.
And they're grousing at each other about how ridiculous they look, like two bears. And it is absolutely hilarious. Then they spring themselves on her.
Oh, and let's not forget, this poor woman, she seems to really be excited about this ice teacher, and he's just a gigolo. He doesn't care about her. She's like, let's go up to bed, and he's like, nah, I'm gonna stay here.
Right, yeah, that whole sequence. She can barely even get him to go to bed with her.
Man, it really sucks. Her life sucks. That's what this movie is saying. It's not presenting her as like an evil figure that is tormenting these men.
Gaston, he breaks up with her, but also gives the lover money to go away. So she doesn't have him, either of them,
no.
At this point.
That's how he saves face, right? That's how he gets the upper hand, by making sure she gets no pleasure out of life.
And then after this absolutely ridiculous sequence,
it plays out in newspapers.
There's this tonally jarring finish to the story, which is that she may have committed suicide and everybody's talking about it.
Yeah, it's the talk of Paris. Did she actually kill herself because she's been disgraced? It's been in all the newspapers. Or did she fake a death and disappear to reinvent her life somewhere else?
Which... And people are congratulating Gaston on his first suicide.
This is an important episode. I guess it would be great to know how much of it is in the novel, exactly as is. But just the way it's all staged, you can see that Audry is trying to make us think about exactly what is this woman's life like? What are her options? She seems like a libertine, but obviously she's not. And there are men just waiting at every doorway to pleasure to block it.
Yeah, I guess I could see that.
Maybe this is what turned Gigi's mom into such a shell. Who knows?
Well, it doesn't look like any of this is fun for anybody.
No, Gaston does it on autopilot. I mean, Honoré seems to enjoy it. He's like, yeah, no, this is what you do. This is what a man in our position has to do. And he seems to be really thrilled. And Gaston's just like, all right, I'm paying this guy off. I'm ruining this woman's life. Now let's go back and have some tea with Mamita, because that was too much exertion for me. He's not reveling in it at all.
No. So, I mean, ultimately, it all wraps up with his realization after this blows up in his face with this mistress that he wants Gigi. Well, I mean, he just realizes that he's in love with her, I guess.
There's an important scene where they all go to the beach. Mamita comes and Honoré just happens to be there with one of his young ladies, and he runs into Mamita and they talk about old times, and she mentions that it broke her heart when their affair ended. He seems to have very fond feelings for her too. I mean, presumably he's the one that introduced Gaston to this whole family of women.
I mean, I guess this is the one humanizing glimpse of Honoré, in that maybe he actually did care about this woman, and if he wasn't so dedicated...
Well, he wasn't allowed to marry her, right? By the conventions of their society. Right. He's a sugar king, and he's got to marry a certain type of woman. You can't step outside. You can do all kinds of illicit things. He was not free to marry a courtesan. Certainly not at that time, or he wouldn't have felt free to do it. It would have been a real violation of convention, which having all kinds of affairs is not, right? It's expected. Nobody's going to reprimand him for that.
Well, they do have a whole discussion. The women in the courtesan family do have a whole discussion of how it can be the case to finally, that you might finally marry. It has happened.
Yeah, but not often, and it would have to be a real decision to go against the grain of society.
So it's not so much that Gaston realizes he wants Gigi to be his mistress, it's just that he doesn't know what else he can possibly do, even though that's a role that's very uncomfortable for her, for both of them.
And he doesn't even suspect, probably, that it's on her side what she would want, right? Her family, the women, are pretty much decided that that's not what you do. You don't get married, so...
Right, and they think that this is a brilliant first lover for her to have, Gaston, despite the horribly creepy fact that up until this minute, he's been acting as her uncle.
Yeah, everyone's on board with it. All the older women are like, no, this is the way we'll go. He will be decent to her, and he'll give her lots of jewels, and we'll just see what happens next. But Gigi doesn't like this when it comes down to it, when she finds out what is being proposed. And as you say, Gaston doesn't exactly want this either. He doesn't just want to have her as a lover. He wants to have her in his life all the time and mostly play cards with her.
Yeah, when he's married, he's just marrying this whole, as you say, homey situation that he's comfortable with.
But right? Again, it takes right until the last moments of the film before he realizes, or it enters his vocabulary, that he can propose to her. There's nothing really stopping him.
And this is the whole masterful sequence of the end of this story that is the same in the Minnelli film, right? Here, I haven't seen the Minnelli film in a long time, so I can't compare. But here I was fascinated by the actors having to make this transition with their characters in front of our eyes from two people who have very believably been in an asexual relationship to two people who have been in love all along, and we are comfortable with them becoming man and wife by the end of the film. And it is very weird and awkward, but all kind of believable.
Brilliantly done. You are happy to see this resolution to the story, I think.
Right, as she makes it clear that the reason that she doesn't want to be his mistress is because that will have an end to it. And she just wants to be with him permanently. That would break her heart. And she also says that she wants to be with anyone permanently. That's what she would prefer. She doesn't want to have an endless string of love affairs.
No.
Even though her aunt really tries to sell it to her, right? How glorious this will be.
Great life.
You don't really fully believe her when she says it. She is kind of trying to sell herself as well. I mean, I think she's enjoyed her life enough, but I don't think she's enjoyed it as much as she'd like to make Gigi believe that she's enjoyed it in order to convince her.
You've got to subsist on memory at that point, because there's no next chapter of the story except to teach your great niece, I guess.
Yeah, true. Get yourself a protege.
That's right. An avatar. So terrific version of Gigi, and certainly makes me want to watch the Minnelli again to compare. I feel like this is gonna emerge as a superior for me.
It's very simple and very astringent, and I don't think you can say either of those things about the Minnelli musical. That's not really what he's going for with his Technicolor musicals.
No. Now we go to Olivia, and this movie is absolutely wild.
Out of these four, this to me emerges as both the richest dramatically, also visually most appealing.
Incredibly beautiful film.
Very beautiful, very sensual in its visuals.
This is a story about a Protestant girls' school in France.
This is a finishing school. This was based on a novel by Dorothy Bussey, who was a Bloomsbury adjacent woman, bohemian type, who was writing her own Claudine à l'école here with perhaps exaggeratedly spicy lesbianism. Perhaps not. I don't know exactly how accurate this was. It was published by Leonard and Virginia Woolf by their Hogarth Press, her only novel, but she seems to have led a very rich life immersed in culture.
And Olivia, the character, is a British girl who comes to study at the school in France.
Yeah, I have no idea if that's part of the novel or if that was just an invention of the French adaptation.
It's interesting though, right? Because she was at a Protestant school, some kind of fire and brimstone Methodist school, it sounds like, where no one had any fun at all. And she comes to this French Huguenot school.
And people are having a little too much fun, to the point where it's not fun anymore.
No, it gets out of hand.
The two headmistresses, one of your favorites.
Well, two of my favorites, really, but especially Edwige Feuillère.
Yeah, and Simone has never looked more beautiful or been better dramatically. I've never seen such a great dramatic performance from Simone. Of course, I've mainly seen her in her American movies. This is a serious dramatic performance from her.
It's pretty serious.
It's pretty damn serious.
There's not one moment of levity with Mademoiselle Cara. Mademoiselle Julie has got a lot more moods. She's a lot more changeable. Just to give you a sense of how this movie was received, I mean, this was a dangerous movie to make in 1951.
Really?
They told the story on the radio about how Edwige Feuillère, a very famous, very popular actress in France. Her career was a little bit jeopardized by making this movie. She talked about going to, I think it was her baker or something, having some kind of transaction with a tradesperson who said, you know, what is the world coming to? I can't take my children to your movies anymore. And she's like, but what if I had played any other sort of criminal? And the guy was like, well, at least that would be clean. This was just as dangerous to make in France as it would have been in the United States, I think, right? To have your audience start to think of you as a creepy lesbian macking on little girls.
Well, that's interesting. Does that then mean that despite the commercial success of her films, that Audry was actually not just making polite, respectable cinema?
Well, that was my argument right at the beginning of this podcast, that no, she's definitely not. I mean, No Exit, whatever else it is, it's certainly not polite and respectable.
It is 10 years since the play had debuted, though. It was definitely a French institution.
But it's not cinéma de papa, and certainly Olivia is not either. Papa would be very upset by Olivia.
Yeah, but cinéma de papa was somehow supposed to include Corneille Prévert movies, which is ridiculous.
I don't think it was ever an accurate description of those films or an accurate evaluation. But it does tell you something about how the Cahiers people were thinking about the movies of this time and how little they were thinking about them, right? If they see someone dressed like it's 1900, they just tune out.
Well, I guess lesbian transgressiveness was not very important to them.
No, apparently not.
So in contrast to Gigi, where it's treated as more or less normal that this adult man wants to marry a 16-year-old girl, this movie does treat the ephebophilia of Miss Julie as a problem that she's aware of herself.
Yeah, she's the problem fighting it.
The problem is not that she's a lesbian. That's definitely not the problem. It would be great if she could just, like, confine herself to her girlfriend, make everybody happy.
Well, that's what Simone wants, that's for sure.
Instead of which, she is irresistibly attracted to her young students, intellectually and physically.
Yes, I mean, unfortunately, she is a hardcore groomer.
She definitely is that.
Do not show this movie to a Republican because they will just use it as material.
I think these girls are all supposed to be, what, do we think they're 15 or 16?
I guess something like that.
Yeah.
It's not clear. Nobody ever says. I think actresses would have been older, I think.
How old are people supposed to be when they go to finishing school? I don't know.
I have no idea. This is not a world that we are familiar with.
They are basically regarded as teenage children in the movie.
They're well-to-do young ladies, and they're supposed to be learning the social graces, then moving on to get married, and Mademoiselle Julie teaches them more than they bargained for. Mademoiselle Julie, everything revolves around her, and I guess Olivia, obviously, who's the title character.
I mean, we might as well talk about the basic setup of the film, which Olivia is immediately thrust into, because this is our point of view character, this new girl being introduced to this well-established world. There are two factions in this school.
Pretty unequal factions.
Corresponding to the two headmistresses, who we pretty quickly understand, as probably would have often been the case. I've certainly heard of other instances from the turn of the century, or thereabouts, of headmistresses of girls' schools, that they are in a lesbian relationship. I don't think most of them were as ravishing looking as these two women are. It's definitely a complete fantasy world, this movie, where your teachers are like the hottest women you've ever seen in your life. But just those two, just the headmistresses, the other teachers look like normal, homely teachers. There's this sort of gothic mystery as to how the school has gotten into this situation and what is wrong with Miss Kara, who is an invalid, very, very cranky invalid, although ravishingly gorgeous and youthful.
But we never see her teach anything. That's long gone. People come to see her occasionally in her room.
She seems to be jealous of the amount of attention that Miss Julie gets, but as soon as the girls do try to pay attention to her, she's so warped and twisted and neurotic at this point that she just pushes them away.
Yeah, well, she's not good at playing the game, right? Because she wants people to be solely fixated on her. Her girlfriend isn't at all. So she wants at least a few of the students, and one of them is. She has one diehard.
Right.
That's pretty much it. Everyone else, you know, they might come in and see her like Olivia does, but they're also drawn to Edwige Fayel, and eventually much more so.
Well, because she's not crazy.
No, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy because Miss Kara just flips out continuously if she hears about anyone looking at Miss Julie.
Or Miss Julie looking at anyone.
Well,
which
yes.
Is And both of these things are constantly happening, so that's a lot of freaking out.
Yeah, she freaks out a lot, just being torn apart by the terrible state of this relationship that she started, I guess, with such promise. They made this school together, became a famous place for people at the well-to-do to come to, so it would be interesting to see the prequel. The young Julie and Kara setting up the school, and when did it start to go wrong exactly? Yeah, what was the first transgression?
It definitely cries out for a prequel, this movie. By the time Olivia enters the picture, to Olivia's great chagrin, Miss Julie is actually trying to stop. Which Olivia absolutely does not want, because she quickly falls into very physically passionate love with Miss Julie. We even get her comparing notes with the former favorite who comes to visit, Laura. And we learn that Laura only platonically loved Miss Julie.
That's right.
But that's definitely not the case for Olivia.
There are a few problems for Olivia and for Miss Julie, because Olivia's not the most beautiful girl at the school. And this is mentioned quite often. There's Celine, that Edwige Feuillel just can't control herself around. She's always talking about how she's paying too much attention to her hairdo and her looks, and you know, there's the big moment, I guess, at the Christmas party where she just completely loses her mind and kisses this girl's neck, and Olivia watches all of that.
It's a very feverish moment, but she also seems to be kind of doing it to torment Olivia, because she does seem to have these very strong feelings for Olivia.
She has strong feelings for Olivia, but she does seem to be doing her best to refrain, because she feels like she's going to destroy her. And it's probably true. Olivia seems like the kind of person that if it actually did become physical and she started to expect that there would be some kind of future to it, she might kill herself or try to kill herself, like some of the former students we hear about.
Maybe.
Like Danielle Delorme, we meet her at the cafe when they go on their excursion. Michelle talks about how Danielle Delorme's character did try to kill herself and was nursed back to health. And why did she try to kill herself? I feel like it's because she was being teased to death by Julie.
Honestly, I thought Miss Julie, maybe you're right, but I just thought Miss Julie was bragging about having seduced her out of anorexia or something.
It's not exactly clear what's going on there, but there's a long history, I think, of teenage girls that have been driven insane by Miss Julie, not just Miss Kara.
What we know for sure is that Miss Julie is disturbed by the force of Olivia's passion.
That's right, exactly. If she can have like a tryst...
Well, I don't mean her emotional passion. I mean her physical passion.
Because she does seem to be having some kind of sexual liaisons with some of the other girls, right? They come to her room, but they're not going to be destroyed by it. You know, they're more superficial. Olivia, it's going to mean something. Something that can't be taken back. And that's why we see Edwige Feuillel several times start to try to kiss Olivia or set up an assignation. She says, je t'amènerai des bonbons. I'll bring you candy. But then she doesn't show up.
The way Edwige Feuillel plays that scene about the candy, she plays it almost like she is afraid that some kind of equal flame is going to be awakened in her if she gives into this.
Well, she's really horned up by kissing Celine. And then she goes over to Olivia and starts talking about how she's going to come visit her that night.
See, we're reading it differently. I read the whole thing as she feels like she's too interested in Olivia, and that's why she's keeping her at arm's length.
It's both. The problem is that she is starting to see the whole situation through Olivia's eyes, and it's freaking
okay,
her out.
That's fair, yeah.
And that's happening because, yeah, she has more respect and is more deeply in love with Olivia, it seems, than any of these other girls she's been trysting
with. Yeah, and that's why this movie is so insanely frustrating to Olivia, because she would like her to be a little less interested in her and just, like, have sex with her.
The movie is really interesting that way, because it can evoke this range of different impressions about what would happen if they did get together or not, right? And what would be the consequences of it. If you're looking at it through Edwige Feuillel's point of view, then you might start to agree with her that it's a good thing that she refrained.
Well, I mean, generally speaking, it's a good thing.
Well, of course, it's because it's really creepy what she's doing anyway.
Well, creepy isn't, I mean, I've already said it a few times. I think it's fair to use creepy with reference to what Honoré is doing in Gigi, but let's try to use more specific and descriptive words to talk about these things. What is wrong with what she's doing here exactly?
Well, these are children in her care.
Yes, age of consent, even when it's quite young, like 15 in France or 16 in Canada, certainly in Canada, it precludes people who are in positions of authority over you or on whom you are dependent.
Yeah, exactly. So
because usually it's because of power relations, but here the problem isn't power relations. The problem is...
There is a lot to the power relation.
No. They're not being pressured to have sex with her, so it's not that kind of power relation problem.
Grooming. It's hardcore grooming. I mean, she's using her function as a critic, and she's tearing Olivia down and building her up again. She's doing all kinds... She's playing all kinds of mind games with Olivia and all the other students.
Well, what's interesting about the movie is that those are kind of normal things that go on between students this age or university age and teachers that they respect anyway. It really is kind of just like an intensification of what student-teacher relationships, if they are pedagogically rich, meaning there's some kind of mutual feeling and respect, what they're like anyway. Less so in high school, but this is a very hot house, closed off in the middle of nowhere, everybody's living together atmosphere in this movie. Certainly in university, right, left, and center, men and women, young men and women, everywhere, were fixated on their teacher, for good and ill. Defending your dissertation, you have a thesis supervisor, whatever, just could be absolutely mentally destroyed by their teacher's opinion of them. This is what pedagogy is like on a normal basis. I definitely had my experiences like that. Dramaturgy can be that way too, when you're working with directors and dramaturges as a writer. Emotions run very high.
They do.
Relationships can get really complex and really destructive. So I don't know, that's a certain universal applicability to this very specific film. I feel like they're already infatuated with her, and then this highly admired teacher role that she plays with them just necessarily inflames that all the more. The reason all these girls are falling in love with her in the first place is because she's gorgeous and charming.
And her beautiful readings.
And they're all a bunch of girls together, and there's no one else to get romantically interested in. It's fascinating that none of them get interested in each other, and none of them look nearly as good as the teacher.
We have the sort of pupil teachers, right? Like La Signorina, the Italian teacher, who's sort of a little bit older. She is teaching, but also kind of a pupil, and she's in love with Mademoiselle Julie as well. Yeah, there are no other nodes of affection except for... It's really just Mademoiselle Julie, because Cara just has one fan.
So what she is really...
And the German teacher, who is not really interested in Cara, she's just interested in getting control of the school, which she does.
So I think I'm getting to the heart of, or we are getting to the heart here, of what is wrong with what this woman is doing, without cliches. She is a charismatic narcissist who
She's a cult leader.
Who has made this entire school about her, about being fixated on her, and she's doing all of this kind of deliberately, but unconsciously, and at the same time as we see her beginning to realize what she's doing and how it's destroying people, starting with her girlfriend.
She's had reservations about it all along, I think, but she just has not been able to help herself. We meet her at this very important juncture in her life where it's all starting to completely fall apart.
And she does have this, because of the teacher role, she does have this undue influence, let's call it, over all of these girls already. Before we get into the sexual stuff.
She's so knowledgeable. She is so well-spoken. Her readings, they bring everyone to tears. I agree with you. She's not doing that solely to make sexual conquests. She's just impressive, and there's nothing that can be done about that. And she thinks she's doing them some good by exposing them to high culture and literature read the way it should be read. Racine.
And then she's just this massive narcissist who, when they fall in love with her, she cannot help taking advantage of that.
That's right. But as she tells us near the end, I mean, the only person that she has ever fully loved, or, you know, as far as she can anyway, as a complete narcissist, is Mademoiselle Cara. And she hasn't really changed her mind about that. And she's putting up with a lot from Cara throughout this movie.
Well, she has made her this way.
True, but if she didn't care about her, she could just, I don't know, get rid of her, have her committed. I mean, she's acting insane. So.
Well, she does ultimately say to the girls that this is the only person I've ever actually loved.
Exactly.
So, yeah, she is a narcissist, and, yeah, this is the only person who's ever managed to, like, break through that even a tiny bit. But, of course, what's fascinating about the movie, at least if you enter into it through Olivia's point of view as powerfully as I did, and the movie invites you to, makes your own morals slip, and makes you ask, but is there anything really actually wrong with what what's going on here. Like, isn't it in fact wonderful to have a teacher like this? A teacher who's so beautiful, brilliant, sensual, totally devoted to molding you into a cultured and well-rounded individual? Like, who wouldn't want to live forever in an atmosphere like this? And at the same time, making you realize that they're living in hell.
Yeah, because the problem is that for all of these girls who are in love with her, there's only one of her. And she's not interested in restricting herself to one person. And that's the problem with Kara. That's what's happened to Simone Simon. She wanted to be just in some kind of monogamous relationship with her girlfriend, and that is not happening. Presumably, all of these other girls would not want to be just stops on the teacher's trip through all of the bedrooms, which is kind of where it's headed in this movie, and it seems to have headed that way many times before. There's not enough of her to go around, and it's just creating problems. That's what's wrong with it more than anything. As much as we talk about grooming, and there is, I mean, this is textbook grooming, I guess. The movie certainly makes it seem like she's not misleading them. They're not mind controlled by her. They desperately want her. It's subjective, their desire for her. It's not imposed on them through magic tricks or anything. So that part, I agree with you. That's where you're going with that, right? That Olivia's desire for her doesn't necessarily have to seem wrong, but she wouldn't get out of it what she wants, as far as I can see.
The only way I see it as being textbook grooming is the fact that a normal teacher-student relationship, if it also has sexual content, would be textbook grooming.
Yeah.
That was the whole point of me detouring into what student-teacher relationships are like anyway.
Whatever you say about it, I don't think Olivia would get out of the relationship what she hopes to get out of it. And that's what makes it seem like maybe fortunate thing that didn't go any further than it did.
They all want
her sole attention.
Her sole attention. And Olivia wants that more than anyone other than Miss Kara. Yes.
And she hates Laura before she even meets her.
But they do become friends.
They do once she finds out that Laura is just this amazing saint who's not even a sexual rival.
Right, true.
Who's just totally removed from it all. Laura is sort of the younger generation equivalent of Victoire, right? Who sort of holds everything together. The actress, again, who played Mamita in Gigi, Yvonne Debré.
And Olivia doesn't even turn out to be that bright. She's obviously not as bright as Laura.
There's nothing special about Olivia.
Except the reason that she's the heroine of this novel and the reason that she attracts Miss Julie in the kind of new and baffling way that she does is that she's more perceptive and she feels more intensely than the other girls.
Yeah, she walks in and Mademoiselle Julie can immediately tell this is the protagonist of a novel.
Yeah.
The novel that's set in my school. So I am interested in her. And I start looking at the world through her eyes.
Yeah.
Just a brilliant movie. I mean, we saw it in the cinema right before COVID hit and I liked it even more this time. But not a happy film, that's for sure. It really gets...
Yeah, and rarely have I seen, maybe short of Mulholland Drive, rarely have I seen as much sexual frustration in any movie as there is in this one. So be prepared for that.
And nobody's getting what they want. Even Edwige Feuillet is mostly frustrated in this movie. She is living with her girlfriend who is too crazy to ever have sex again, probably. And all these girls around, you know, there are landmines everywhere. And, you know, she loses everything. I mean, it's terrible, right? I mean, and the one person who sucks the most, the German teacher, she's like Nurse Ratched or whatever. She's the one that inherits the school. She may have even killed Mademoiselle Kara. It's kind of a mystery that doesn't get solved.
Right.
Like, did she commit suicide? Was there some kind of plot to kill her? The usual suspects who hated Mademoiselle Kara, I think we realize that none of them did it. But the German teacher, Kara dies, and Kara, now hating Julie, had signed over all of the school to Frau Riesner. Yeah, so she is going to be in charge of this school. It's going to be awful. She's going to be barking. She's going to be like Gretchen and Benson.
Yeah, we're going to swing too far in the direction of non-sensuality, or maybe this will just be a completely different type of lesbianism.
She doesn't seem to have any feelings at all. Victoire is not sticking around for that, and she kind of gives Olivia some life lessons along the way. You kind of dodged a bullet here. I really like the math teacher too.
The math teacher who hates math.
She's like, math, it's useless.
Let's face it.
Who cares about math? She just cares about indulging her taste for all these delicious treats that the cook is making. But she also knows what's going on. She can see the terrible effects, the way everyone is suffering around her, and she can't do anything about it either. Just keeps eating these snacks.
It's a little bit of an anchor of normalcy in the midst of all this.
Down-to-earth, comprehensible desires that don't hurt anyone.
Yeah, if only Miss Julie just had too much of an appetite for snacks.
Pour des bonbons. All right, let's go into huis clos. No exit. This was my least favorite by far.
I don't agree. I liked it a lot.
I didn't dislike it, but on the other hand, I just feel like it's kind of a limited play.
Well, it definitely is. It's not like Jean-Paul Sartre is one of the great dramatists of all time.
No, it's basically an essay in dramatic form.
Annabella was in the first Broadway production in 1946. So that gives you an idea of the range of possible interpretations of the Inez character.
Right.
So what have we got here?
First, a little prologue that tells us the entire point of the story, Hell is Other People.
Yeah, we get that quite a few times, the Hell is Other People thing.
It's a position piece, and the movie and the play, they are designed to illustrate that one point, really.
That doesn't interest me very much at all. I mean, to the extent that that is interesting, I first heard about this play and that phrase not long after I was reading about Colette when I was like 14 or 15. And then you're like, whoa, profound. And, you know, then you just absorb it as one of those 20th century cliches that people just carry around with them. No, what interested me was the Sartre idea of the gaze, the one of whose distant progeny is the male gaze, which, you know, you get quite a bit of that in this movie. We've got a man who only cares that he is seen by other people as a man and feels like he's not. We've got a woman who only cares about being desired by men because that's the only thing that gives her any kind of real valid existence. And we have a lesbian who, I don't really know how her desire even gets started in this philosophy, because why would she be desiring a woman? Do we actually admit biology in this philosophy? I don't know. And is it biology? Is homosexuality biology? I don't even know. But the point is that her gaze can't do anything for this woman, so she just spends all of her time being in the most abject condition of womanhood, right? Because she can't be loved in any way that she wants. Her lust can't validate these women that she's interested in. But at the same time, sometimes she can become an honorary man to the other man, but she can never be a man to the women in the way that she wants to.
Right. The movie certainly seems to be saying that Arletty is in a kind of competitive relationship with men. I mean, she talks about this a lot, and unfortunately a relationship that she's always going to lose just by default, by social convention.
Right, but this has to do, like I'm saying, with, I mean, it's a very unflattering very unflattering portrait of lesbianism, and also we've seen this in other films, even that Kanuo Tanaka film, Nymphomaniacs, that are going to crazy with lust at the sight of any attractive woman.
Yeah.
Putting that aside, what Sartre seems to be studying there with the two women is the position of women in a patriarchal society, obviously. So, like I said, she is in competition with men because only the male patriarchal gaze can validate the existence of cis-het women.
Yeah, and she's unable to impersonate the male gaze to the satisfaction of any of the women that she's chasing after.
She can take advantage of their resentment of men, which she seems to have done, you know, their rightful resentment of patriarchal society, which she seems to have done with this woman that she alienated from her husband. But these weak heterosexual women are always going to go back to resume their place in patriarchal society because that's the only way they're getting validation in it. I mean, you can really see the seeds of Simone de Beauvoir's feminism, the second sex, in these ideas, which I'm sure they discussed plentifully together.
No doubt. The core of it is that you put any two people together for the rest of eternity and they probably will make some kind of peace. Any two of them would just...
They'll develop some kind of love relationship.
But when you have a third person in the room, nothing good can come of it.
Right, because it'll turn into a triangle, and if the other two try to develop this love relationship, the resentful, left-out person will be gazing at them and objectifying them in horrifying ways.
Exactly.
And Arletty, the interesting thing thing about the Inez character is that she's the one who has, I guess because she's the most outsider, the most object, she's the one who has total perspective and understands what's going on at all points and can articulate it for them all.
Right, but she's just as wounded and sick.
Well, I mean, that's what's so great about Arletty's performance, that she has this believably authoritative position, and at the same time, she's just a vicious open wound.
Over and over again, she's been rebuked by the world. Nobody can love her the way that she would want, or can respond to her affection the way that she wants. And all she can see and are competitors and losers.
Her lack of interest in men has turned into a hatred because of this competition.
Yeah, absolutely. Because any schlub can come along and win if it's a choice between the two of them. And as we're told,
Absolutely anyone, even though they might be more sexually attracted to her in some cases.
Yeah, I mean, Estelle doesn't care what this guy has done or even what he looks like or anything else because he's the only man left.
You've got to admit, this is all really fascinating, and can you imagine how mind-blowing these ideas would have been to see in the original stage play?
Agree with all of that. It's just that it's kind of clear from the first moment that the door closes what's going to happen, and it's...
Well, yeah, it's not dramatically suspenseful.
By design that it has to go this way.
For eternity.
It's got to terminate in more people saying hell is other people, and they do.
It's absolutely fascinatingly executed, though, by Sartre, and by the actors in this movie. I'm actually liking it more now that we're talking about it as a play. Now, Audrey does open it out in a way that you're not supposed to do with plays like this, but she is a commercial filmmaker, so she was probably like, no one's going to come and see this otherwise. She does open it out by giving them this movie screen that they look out onto.
That was my favorite part, where they turn the sofa around and the concierge comes in and is like, oh, you got it set up like a movie theater.
Yeah, it's suddenly becoming very Lynchian. As far as I can tell, there was, just from reading the Wikipedia description, there's nothing like this in the stage play. I guess all of this stuff was just narrated.
Yeah, I read the play, but it was a long time ago. That sounds right, though. I mean, they don't have flashbacks, I don't think, in the play, so makes sense, yeah.
Probably the most awful and morbid idea, the most cynical and nihilistic thing in the play wasn't this hell is other people idea, which is kind of fascinating, and really more of a commentary on patriarchal society than anything else, but this idea that people are immediately forgotten upon their death, which doesn't seem true to my experience.
Well, it's certainly not true in the human comedy.
No, this is kind of an anti-human comedy.
It would be interesting to have Saroyan and Sartre.
As a double feature?
Yeah, or just have them in a room chatting about their philosophies of life. I suppose there would be some disagreements there. No shortage of dark moments in this movie. Estelle threw her baby out the window into a lake.
Yes, compared to what Estelle and Garcin, as they call him, have done, it's hard to understand what Inez has done so wrong, unless the idea is that everyone goes to hell because everyone has something they're tearing themselves apart about.
Yeah, everyone hates themselves at bottom. I think Sartre believes that.
And part of the reason for them dwelling on how they're being viewed by the living, like the people that they loved, or I feel like Garcin did love this friend of his, and Inez did love her girlfriend. I don't know if Estelle loved anyone, but she did want this one boy to love her. But again, these are other people who they want to serve as mirrors of them, to have these ideals of them, to perceive them the way that they want to be perceived.
Yeah.
And what they're watching is those images being shattered.
Yeah, this is not a Judeo-Christian hell. There's no talk about actual sin here. Although real sins do seem to have been committed. For the most part, yeah, it's just self-hatred that lands you in hell, in this hell hotel. Everyone has that, I think, at a certain level, according to Sartre. I'm not sure if it's actually true, but everyone certainly doubts themselves or feels like they didn't act in the best way at certain moments, and I guess that's all the weakness you need to buy yourself a ticket to hell. And nobody actually judges them. I guess the only people who aren't in hell are the people that work there, and I don't know how they got that job, but the concierge certainly has some funny moments.
This movie is very convincingly hellish. Hellish to watch. Kind of the one break in all of that is when they all start laughing at the end. Like, I genuinely felt like, okay, so it's not going to be that bad, because every few hours in eternity, they're all going to burst out laughing at the absurdity of their situation. And for one moment, they'll be in harmony.
Wow. That, I felt that was the most hellish moment of all.
But... Well, I think that's how you're supposed to feel about it. But for me, it was like comparatively a relief.
A moment of levity for Elise, that they've completely cracked and had nervous breakdowns and are cackling.
Yeah, they're suddenly dissociated from the situation. That's the best you can hope for here, that there's a periodic dissociation.
Go to Club Elise and get your release from reality by laughing maniacally. She'll drive you insane and you'll love it.
Is that your summary of our relationship on our 10th anniversary?
Yes, that's right. We're recording on our 10th anniversary. But no, because we live in an apartment à deux, we can...
There are three of us here, actually.
Yes.
There's you and me and the cat.
But
and...
the cat is just an angelic being.
Not tonight, she's not. She's a very misbehaved cat who isn't happy with us for podcasting.
But no, we can live in this illusion of love together. And I think we have. And if we had a third person around, it would be miserable in this apartment.
There's sometimes a triangle with the cat. There's sometimes a slight triangle. But for the most part, we all love each other.
We don't even need an exit.
You rarely take advantage of the exit, Dave, other than to walk around the neighborhood. One last movie in the Audry sequence.
So Les Petits Matins comes a few years later, 1962. La Nouvelle Vague is in full effect. Varda has been making movies. Many Cahiers de Cinéma guys have put down their pens and taken up the camera.
This is a very, very, very gentle New Wave movie, though.
Yeah, it's one of my favorites. I think it was incredible.
So this actress was a non-actress.
She's so good. Agathe Ayens.
It is sadly one of those movies of the, like, literally of the 1,000 men and one woman, other than Arletty.
I love Arletty's little cameo. We can talk about that as we go along.
So Agathe, who's played by Agathe, I did love her. This non-actress, she is completely adorable and very deadpan funny in the way that that has to be the linchpin of the entire movie.
Yeah, and she is cast against, as you say, a huge number of men, many of them stars of French cinema.
Yeah.
And holds her own against all of them in great style. The movie opens, she's on a beach. I guess it's, you know, the English Channel or the North Sea. She's Belgian. She's won a beauty contest and been sent to this beach, which is really not very pleasant. It's raining. Even if it wasn't raining, it would be cold. Belgium's not the place to lie on the beach. And she actually gets the idea to go to the Côte d'Azur from a guy that creeps on her on the beach. This guy offers her an umbrella and then will not stop grabbing her. And that's the tone the movie sets.
Not consistently. I guess the majority of the men that she meets try to molest her, but by no means all of them.
No. But her reaction to it, you know, she, as you say, she's very deadpan. She's so used to this by now that she just deflects him offhandedly.
No, I loved the blank face of this actress. The blank pixie face of this actress. It's absolutely amazing.
She's like, oh, while you're groping me, you've given me a good idea. I'm gonna hitchhike to the Côte d'Azur. Thanks for that. Now I'm leaving.
It's like the perfect blankness of the ideal new wave 18-year-old heroine, but funny.
Oh, she's so funny. I like her so much more than...
You wanted to say Anna Karina, but you know that I like Anna Karina.
I like Anna Karina too, but I think I like her more.
Anna Karina is the only thing that saves those 60s Godard movies for me.
Well, I mean, this movie has totally different intentions than a Godard movie.
Well, no, this movie is very... It's not really a new wave movie, although maybe it shares something in common with the Vardas in that it's very, very sweet and soft.
Exactly.
And so is this girl's face.
No, she has a real picaresque adventure. I mean, that's what it is.
Yeah, a picaresque adventure that she ends up finding love, spoilers, at the end of.
But before that happens, she just gets into all kinds of...
Well, you could say it's a sort of Ulysses tale.
Something is waiting for her. Something better than she's had in her life is waiting for her on the Mediterranean Sea.
And I love her totally blank comic internal monologues.
She just talks to herself, or, I mean,
she calls herself a voiceover too, doesn't she?
Yeah, it's voiceover, and she's like, I'm gonna have to get back after all of this. Like, she's not even down there. She's been through so much, and she's thinking ahead to, I'm gonna have to hitchhike back to Belgium later. Fortunately for her, she doesn't have to do that. She's gonna get married to a guy who is getting a promotion, and he's gonna be the Belgian or Northwest salesperson for his firm.
Brush salesperson.
He's a brush guy, the Fuller brush guy. I like the stuff at the border, the guy that detains her for quite a while asking her questions.
And he can't do math. He thinks she's 16.
Yeah, that was amazing. Like, right off the bat, just completely unimpressed by authority. This guy, she just dresses him down for being a complete fool, for being unable to tell from her birth date that she's 18.
Tells her a long, boring story about, you know, his youth when he...
Yes, you must go to Paris. Now, as she walks across the border, there are all these guys in line in their cars, all of them eager to give her a lift because they think they're going to have a romantic conquest out of it.
Well, there's two guys in a bad car and then two guys in a good car, but the bad car catches up with her first.
Yeah, and she prefers the bad car. She thinks these guys seem more sympathetic, and it turns out that they are. It's a boxer and his manager. They don't really act gross with her at all.
No, I don't think so.
She likes them, right? Like, when they get to Paris, she goes to the boxing match and watches it. And
fouls it up.
Yeah, well...
It's not her fault. She's actually trying to get this dummy... That whole sequence was hilarious.
Bobby!
Use your right hook! Why isn't he using his right hook? I don't know why he's not using his... He's got a great right hook.
Yeah,
he never uses it.
No. And he looks back and gets cold-cocked, and he's knocked out immediately.
There's so much not being gross with her that afterwards she tries to get them to go out, but they need to go to bed.
Yeah, they're tired. They're amateur boxers, so they don't do this for a living. They've got actual jobs, too. So she's stuck with these rich guys. Winds up spending a lot of time with the older rich guy.
It's a massive meal out of him.
She teases him to the point where he has to admit that he's old enough to be her father, and he doesn't necessarily like that. And then she starts calling him Papa.
Papa!
Yeah, it's hilarious. She's not completely invincible either, right? Like, she is vulnerable, and the movie does play that up a little bit, too.
Well, I mean, obviously...
These guys can overpower her.
Obviously, a cute 18-year-old girl hitchhiking would be in much more perilous situations than... It probably wouldn't go as well as it does for this girl here, unless she really knew how to defend herself. And definitely this girl does not.
No, her defense is deadpan and sarcasm and deflating these men.
And quick escapes.
Yeah, and it mostly works, and when that doesn't, she thinks quickly, as you say, and she ducks into buildings and hides, right? So she's not...
And then she's always ready for the next adventure and the next sort of semi-con that she has to pull.
Yeah, right? She incorporates a lot of little elements of the story into her running narrative. When she meets the next person, she tells them that she lives, or she was born and grew up on Rue Jules Verne, which is not true. That's just a building that she was hiding in to get away from the rich middle-aged guy. There she meets a pilot who's very nice with her. He drives her. He says he's going to the Côte d'Azur, and she's like, oh, just one shot.
He tries to give her a ticket in a moment of generosity, and in a moment of foolish pride, she turns him down.
Yeah, and then she's like, no, I have to get that ticket back. And she sits there at the... Yeah, she's got a lot of interesting vacillations back and forth. Certainly not a pure con artist of any sort. She is just a totally whimsical being. Like, she makes a different decision every minute.
Yeah, obviously, which is supposed to be kind of the essence of the new wave, right? This new wave heroine.
So while she's sitting at the airport trying to figure out what to do, Pierre Brasseur comes over, who we've seen in lots of movies. You know, he's in Enfant de Paradis and Quai des Brumes, much older in this movie, and he's a businessman who's like, you know, what can I do to help you? And again, she plays it wrong if she wants to get a ticket, because she tells him this sob story about how she lost her ticket, and he's like, well, just tell them you lost your ticket. They must have a duplicate.
Well, he knows the whole time what she's driving at.
Yeah, but he wants her to ask, and she won't, right?
I love how she just keeps ordering croissants with butter and jam and cafe au lait over and over.
Yeah, she does get that paid for often, sometimes she pays for it.
She loves her food.
She does, and she's, you know, on a long journey. She needs fuel. But and she's telling ridiculous lies to Pierre Brasseur about how she's a confidential secretary who speaks foreign languages.
She decides Turkish is the one that he'll never know.
But his business card later reveals that he has dealings in Istanbul, so... Yeah, she picked the wrong one. He gives her his card and he's like, yeah, just let me know if you ever need anything. But she's too mortified by how all the wrong steps she's taken there. So she's, stuck, never gets on that plane.
I mean, who are some of the great new wave heroines of the whimsical sort other than Anna Karina? Well, in some of the movies. In others, she's like a deadly femme fatale. Juliette Berthaud from Celine and Julie and other Rivette films is another one of those new wave creatures of whimsy.
Sure, and although trapped in this much more gothic universe that's working against her and everyone in it.
And she also plays this kind of vagabond character in Out One who has to survive a little bit by her wits.
So, I mean, Rivette is sort of an interesting case because he does seem to have more interest in female characters than a lot of the other new waivers.
Yeah, he's later as well.
Yeah, I guess the one great Godard exception in my mind is Deux, trois choses je connais d'elle. So we'll be watching that at some point when we do Marina Vladi.
But is that a character anything like this?
No, definitely not.
Nothing like this.
Yeah. No, she's not whimsical. No, but she's very interesting.
There's just one bizarre situation after another to the point where at times it was reminding me of After Hours, although it never gets to that paranoid fever pitch.
Well, except for the one time that she's taken hostage by kind of Anthony Perkins type guy.
Right. But that little skit ends with her being more afraid of his mother, sort of indulges and also controls him.
Crazy, that whole scene. I mean, she meets him at a diner and gets a lift with him in his cool car, and he's like, should have had some second thoughts because I'm a crazy maniac. Are you afraid? Are you afraid? And she's like, no.
It reminded me of the Lucille Ball encounter with Boris Karloff in Lured, sort of noirish sir.
It's a little bit like that, although it's got a lot to do with Psycho as well, and this was made right after Psycho, I think. You gotta keep that in mind as a precursor. But finally she does freak out when he does attack her with a halberd or some kind of medieval weapon, driven crazy by the fact that she won't scream or won't be afraid, and he actually does try to kill her, and then his mother tells him to stop and he goes away.
Tells a goth to feel free to stay and stay overnight and don't worry, he's harmless.
Yeah, but not mom. Mom is not harmless.
There were also some quite just sweet or banal encounters with...
The bus driver was cool.
With the bus driver, and then later, the longer one, furniture salesman, who turns out to be involved with Arletty.
Yeah, that's a really interesting sequence. Driving for a long time, they stop.
Neither of those guys bother her at all.
No.
And she gets along with them in a really fun way. They play off of each other nicely.
Yeah, and they're both sort of talking disdainfully about the younger generation and the crazy things that they're getting up to in the 1960s. And she also says that she hates young people. But it's interesting, you know, like, she really isn't out for just a good time in a typical teenage way. And you could see that she wants to interact with a different, you know, segment of the population than she's been able to.
Is she like Gigi?
Yeah, exactly. That's what I was kind of thinking, right? She's looking for a different place than society wants to ascribe to her.
One of the very few female characters who shows up in the movie is distinctly contrasted with this actual lamb-like innocent Agathe. And there's nothing wrong with this other character.
No, the two girls who are hitchhiking in the convertible, Agathe is in the backseat with the dog.
With the poodle.
And the other woman is, you know, letting the driver know that she's up for a little sex on the side of the road before he drops them off.
Yeah, and I don't think she's demonized.
No, of course not. No, I mean, they seem to be very friendly. Nobody's acting... She's not jealous or anything either, right? It's just two different approaches to life on the road.
But then they each go off with a motorcyclist, which Agathe didn't want to do in the first place.
No, and she was right. This motorcyclist sucks.
Yeah, so this is the closest she gets to actually being raped, and the movie to kind of acknowledging the actual dangers that a girl on the road would face. Yeah, but luckily, because who wants realism, this turns out to just be a sort of novelette-ish interlude that sets up her being rescued by Prince Charming, like Jane Austen's Emma.
Yeah, and she actually thinks to herself immediately, is this Prince Charming?
Yeah, in her completely blank way.
Yeah, it turns out he is, although there's some doubt about it for a little while.
Yeah, we have to be a little bit teased at the end there and see her reaction to the possibility that this could be the one for her, or that he could be abandoning her after they finally sleep together, and evidently sleeping with somebody actually means something to her.
Yeah, she seems very happy the next morning, and the guy seems a little bit distracted.
And she's made it to the sea, although she can't believe it because it's not very spectacular.
No. She has to be ready to just go off on her own on this boat, one way or the other. But the guy happens to have planned to come back, or he was feeling a little bit terrified because he likes her so much, which of course we know that is something. It all happens so quickly in this movie, but yes, being pulled into someone else's orbit is scary. That's reasonable. We should talk about the very odd scene with our Letty. So this is her journey with the furniture salesman.
Right, they end up in a restaurant where he introduces her to his girlfriend, Arletty.
And they have a kind of deepening of their relationship where they rekindle their passion for each other by putting Agathe to bed. It's bizarre.
And they treat her just like a child, like she actually passes out from tiredness and he carries her up to bed, which of course this couldn't happen with an adult because adults don't go into tiredness coma the way children do.
No.
Tiredness comas the way children do. Then they undress her like she's a child, and I don't think it's intended to be creepy.
Well, it can't help but be a little creepy, but it's also very sweet somehow.
Well, he's weirded out.
Yeah.
He's there in the room and he's weirded out because he really doesn't seem to be sexually interested in her, and the idea that she's being undressed in front of him by his girlfriend is weirding him out.
But she does represent vitality in a way to them, that something that they may have lost. And the fact that his girlfriend is jealous that he's been on the road with this young girl does seem to excite him as well. And they leave the room definitely prepared for a night of passion.
Yeah. Also, the changeability of Arletty, because she's many years older here than in No Exit, but looks actually sexy and glamorous in this movie.
Just a wonderful actress, Arletty. I mean, we've discussed her before. Incredibly important to the carnet oeuvre, but great to see that she's going on and doing these other things.
I don't think she was doing much at all at this point. I did look it up. I think this is one of her very, or if not her very last appearance.
Well, it's a good way to go out.
In film. No, it's not true. She was in quite a few things in 1962, but that was the last year that she appeared in several movies. Not much else in film after 1962.
Still, that's a pretty good long career. I mean, especially for someone who got into so much trouble during World War II, as we discussed in our Carnet episode. Reputation appears to have been rehabilitated to the point where she could work quite a lot in the 50s and early 60s. As you say, this is not a movie that is saying anything cynical or trenchant about the world. It's really kind of a wonderful adventure that leaves you feeling really quite pleased with everything.
Which doesn't seem right for the new wave, unless you are thinking of people kind of on its fringes, like, Agnes Varda isn't on its fringes, but she's out of step with what we think of as the Kaye new wave circle. Jacques Demy as well can make movies that are in some ways very sweet.
I do think Godard movies are very interesting, and Truffaut and Romare and all the others, of course, important, but there's this other side to the film culture at the time that, you know, we need to keep in mind. And I'm glad that we saw this. Never heard of this movie, of course.
Well, I'm a Philistine who would have liked Godard to keep using Anna Karina in the way that seems natural for her personality, which is La Femme et la Femme, which is just an absolutely silly, light, whimsical comedy.
That wasn't Godard's plan, sadly. All right, well, I hope that we do have a part two. I hope that all of Audry's other movies get subtitles, or possibly at least we'll learn French in the next 15 years and we'll just watch them that way.
That'll happen.
All right, how about Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto, Elise? Sweet Charity.
Funnily enough, we weren't even thinking about this when we watched that Daniel Day-Lewis movie, Nine?
Yeah.
It is just called Nine, right? A musical adaptation of Fellini's 8½. But this is another musical adaptation of a Fellini movie. I didn't really know anything about it because I don't know anything about or enjoy Broadway musicals. And this was a good reminder of exactly how much I absolutely loathe them.
Pretty interesting. This is a movie I've never watched before. Wanted us to go because I was on the schedule and it was restored. I love Shirley MacLaine.
If you love Broadway musicals and if you love Bob Fosse, don't even listen to this next segment. Like, I'm just warning you, don't do it.
Well, the thing about this movie is I really enjoyed it, and everything was against me liking it. I don't like the music.
Oh my god, I hated it so much. So much.
I mean, I love 20s, 30s, 40s Broadway musicals. Love that stuff, but after that period, yeah, I hate it. I hate the way the music for Broadway began to sound. It's all very brassy. Big Spender, I don't like that song.
Well, this is where you and I differ. This is a place where we differ, which is I'm not a fan of a complex cinematic work of art being lobotomized in musical form, but you're absolutely okay with that. You like the musical adaptation of Shop Around the Corner.
Sure, sure, but...
But this is a lobotomy of Knights of Cabiria. It's an atrocity, and Shirley MacLaine is doing a grotesque self-parody.
Oh, I love Shirley MacLaine in this movie. No, I thought she was great.
No, no.
Well, I can't not love Shirley MacLaine.
Well,
so.
I found out that I can not love her. And nobody should ever, ever jump as much in a movie as several characters do throughout this movie. Ever.
Too much jumping.
It's an abomination. It's a lobotomy and an abomination.
Yikes. Well, I'm sorry I subjected you to that, at least. So we had very different experiences, I think.
I was in hell. So maybe you should talk about it. Knights of Cabiria is one of my top 10 movies, and I never put it on my top 10 because it's, like, way too obvious, but I really love that movie, which is a delicate, wondrous magic trick, and it shouldn't work, and Giulietta Messina's performance shouldn't work. It's just a miracle to watch them, Fellini and her, pull that off. This movie is a reminder of how it shouldn't work.
Well, don't you think that at the very least, I know that you don't think it did work, but if you were going to cast a role that had been played by Giulietta Messina, wouldn't it be Shirley MacLaine?
No, because this movie, I would have thought so before seeing this movie, but this movie really drove home for me how actually radically different their personas are. There's nothing, I mean, Shirley MacLaine just kept playing these weird, fey, innocent, manic pixie dream girl, fallen woman roles, which I've always thought was very curious about her as a persona, but the much, much better version of this performance is in Some Came Running.
Well, yeah.
It's the exact same performance, and it's 1,000 times directed better by Minnelli.
Well, no, of course, you can't really compare.
See, even Minnelli gets a lobotomy when he does a musical adaptation. I don't have anything against original movie musicals at all. I love them, but adaptations should never happen. This made me think that, like, if anyone was going to, could do what Giulietta Messina does in that role, it would be someone more like Judy Garland, if you could imagine Judy Garland playing a prostitute.
Interesting idea.
Before I say what I did like about the movie, because there was a couple of things I did like, you should talk about what you liked so much about it, because I've said enough.
Well, the moments where you're supposed to get an emotional gut punch because you're feeling along with Shirley MacLaine, it always works on me. I mean, it upset me to see her getting hurt like that. She's able to do that no matter what the setting. Of course, I agree. Bob Fosse is not Minnelli. There's so much going on in this movie that I didn't need. I did really like the performance of John McMartin, who plays the sort of final love interest who seems poised to take her out of all of this misery, but then is revealed to be not worthy of her.
And he was in the original Broadway production.
Yeah, he's really good, I think, in this movie. And I didn't really know that he was such a big deal. I've seen him in lots of movies in the 80s. He's in Blowout and he's in Legal Eagles, but always as a kind of middle-aged, kind of sinister guy.
This role doesn't exist in the Fellini film. I don't know how well you remember it.
But no.
Not at all. This movie takes a turn into something like a very well-known trope, but that by the mid-60s is ancient and hoary. Probably the best version of it is in Bresson's Ladies of the Bois de Boulogne, which is the man who learns after he falls in love with a gamin woman who he imagines is a innocent, sweet, sexless angel, and she turns out to be a whore, and he has a hard time dealing with that.
Well, he can't deal with it. He gives
up.
Well,
in this movie, he can't. In Bresson, spoilers, it's a little more complex.
But I think that's an interesting choice here. He's not up to the challenge, ultimately. He knows that he's wrong, but he can't do it. And he just walks out and she's by herself. I thought he was really good in that role. And they've got some good little comedy moments in the elevator. And camaraderie between the hostesses was kind of fun.
So loud and so broadcast and brassy.
Cheetah Rivera was one of the best friends.
Once it started doing its own thing, thing with that plot instead of doing the Fellini movie, I liked it a lot better.
Yeah, yeah, well, that's the best part of the movie, the when she meets him and all that stuff happens.
And then when she introduces him to her friends and, you know, the penny drops.
Exactly,
and yeah. We start to realize how this is all going to fall apart long before she does.
Long before he really does, either. I mean, he's already told her, yeah, I've forgiven you. We'll just not talk about it ever again. And of course, you know the way that's being said, that that's a problem. But you're wondering, does the movie know that? It does, of course.
I mean, this trope is so old by this point of this movie that I hate myself for it working. It shouldn't.
You did think it was going to be happily ever after?
I didn't know at the point at which she meets this guy and the initial point of their relationship, I had no idea how they were going to get to the Fellini ending. I had no idea. And then when I started realizing what they were doing, I was like, oh, now I see. And then I was just dreading it. What interested me is that the very end, which is the Fellini ending, the very ending of her, spoilers, recovery of optimism.
Yeah.
In the face of, like, it ought to be impossible. It's just kind of an act of grace that it happens. It happens for no reason. It's as mysterious as Greta Garbo at the end of Queen Christina. Her face is why Charity or Kaberia manages to recover optimism at the end. And she's very opaque, certainly in the Fellini movie. But the fact that that's a scene that shouldn't ever work in any movie ever, that idea shouldn't work. The fact that it works in this movie that I didn't think was very good, again, I have to give all due respect to Fellini, because apparently that was just a really great idea. Because when it happens at the end of this movie, I was sobbing again, just like I do at the end of Knights of Kaberia.
Okay,
sobbing.
So you didn't have the worst time in the world at this movie. If you had an emotional reaction.
For two-thirds of it, I surely did.
Okay, well, still, I feel vindicated. Because, yeah, I really thought it was quite a moving ending.
No, that's like one of the most moving endings of all time, and apparently survived transition into this awful Broadway musical.
All right. Go see it, Sweet Charity. Next week, we're back to Dorothy McGuire. We'll be watching Make Haste to Live and Three Coins in the Fountain, two movies from 1954.